Alan Herman, the director of the Whitaker Institute here in Edinburgh, Galway. I'd like to introduce you to my fellow panelists. I'll be chairing this event. By presiding here, on my left is Michael J. Driscoll. Michael is Professor of Finance at the Wunstead School of Business at Delft University. It's in Long Island, New York. Michael has been there, I think, since 2010, teaching undergraduates and graduates in finance and business. Before that, a very long and distinguished and interesting career on Wall Street. Like, it was 28 years on Wall Street, including 5 years, I think, at Smith Barney, or 10 years at Smith Barney, 5 years at Bear Stearns, involved in a number of other financial services companies, including being a founding member of its own hedge fund. So very, very interesting to be. We're really delighted, Michael, that you could join us, and really look forward to it. I think it's going to be very interesting. Michael has been a frequent contributor to global media outlets such as Bloomberg, CNN, Voice of America, and is visiting in what I call with some of the US Fulbright's questions. Our panelist needs no introduction to this audience. Mr. John McHale is the established professor of economics and dean of the College of Business, Public Policy and Law here at the University of Galway. And he has served as chairman of the Irish Fiscal Advisory Council from 2011 to 2016, and previously held academic positions at Harvard University, Queen University in Ontario, Canada, and is currently president of the Irish Economic Association. So thank you, John, for joining us. And the format today is it's a little quirky. We'll take about 40 minutes in a format where the three of us are, think of a pub, three high stools, somewhere in a wet evening in Galway, and we're just having a conversation. And you might think that three prime-age males like to be talking about sports or women or something like that. No, we're going to talk about economics, finance, and the global economy in markets. And so you folks are in the pub and you're sort of eavesdropping on this conversation. So that's the way we're going to do it. And then after maybe about 40 minutes or so, we're going to ask you to join our conversation, maybe buy us a few pints, and we'll also open the floor for questions and answers. So it's slightly unusual. It's different than I think we're used to, and different, I guess, than you're used to. But I think it should be informative. I hope it will be very, very interesting. So maybe we could give a real overview of the global economy. And Michael, maybe we'll start asking you what your views are about the main strengths and weaknesses in the global economy.
Thanks very much, Alan, and thank you to NUI and everybody at the NUIG for making me feel so at home in these last weeks. Global economy, in my opinion, I think is at a tricky, almost like an inflection point right now. We all are aware of all the geopolitical factors out there, a lot of them emanating from the U.S. at this point in time. The current expansion is getting a bit long in the tooth. I think, if we go back to probably 2007, 2008, so 9, 10 years, a long time for kind of this expansion that we've been in. I think that as long as this expansion has lasted, it's been confined. It's really kind of segregated to, in the U.S. at any rate, to a very high earning portion of the population, the most successful businesses. I mean, just back up to my finance background for a little bit, a lot of the move in the U.S. stock market is confined to really like four or five different stocks: Amazon, Facebook, Google, Netflix. So it's really not a broad-based kind of rising tide, floating all ships recovery, in my opinion. And I think the numbers and the performance kind of masks a lot of what's going on. Unemployment rates, particularly in the U.S., down to 4.3, but much kind of this conversation I had with a couple of friends in Ireland earlier today, and as we're in this room, it doesn't, to look at the statistics, it sounds great, but it doesn't feel great. When you talk to people, no one's terribly positive or enthused. It's kind of the same feeling in the U.S. that kind of that malaise or just expectations of that. Yeah, the numbers look good, but I'm, personally, I'm not doing that great, and I don't really know anybody.
reasonably good. I think we're in a cyclical recovery at the moment. Might say it's getting a little bit longer, particularly in the US. On the other hand, I think we're in the early stages of that recovery in Europe. So those are the short-term prospects. But so partly getting at what Mike said from another angle, I think sort of the longer-term prospects are of concern. And it's a bit of a puzzle here in that we seem to be in this period where there's an incredible technological change, talk about artificial intelligence and robots. On the other hand, over the last number of decades, the growth rate seems to be falling. Rather than rising despite this incredible technical change. And one place that the technical change does seem to be showing up is in terms of income distribution. And again, this gets to some of the things that Mike was talking about. You're seeing sort of polarization in the labor market, and particularly people in the middle, people who may not have had huge amounts of education, doing good jobs, those good jobs. So, getting scarcer and scarcer. On the other hand, at the lower skill end of the labor market, offering personal services, the demand is still there for very low wages. And then there's people doing very well, people with skills across the department and technologies. So that is our concern. And then on the demand side, in the long term, there is this notion of secular stagnation, where we don't seem to be able to generate enough demand to make sure that we're sort of deploying all resources. And even though at the moment we seem to have in such a bad position, so there really is a concern that if the world economy would be hit by some other negative event, that central banks just don't have the scope to reduce interest rates and ensure there's sufficient demand to avoid a big increase in unemployment. So these sort of longer term forces.
And Mike, so you both spoke about the recovery going on, but it seems to be a small group of people that are benefiting, and that's apparently. Do you think that explains in part, or large part, the geopolitical outcomes that we're seeing? Where said, a lot of people in this country scratched their heads saying, how did Trump win the US presidential election? Do you think it's these sort of developments are contributing?
Absolutely. I mean, I did a radio interview earlier today where I kind of made the point that the canary in the coal mine for this to me was 4 years ago in the summer of 2013. I spent a big chunk of time in Hungary. And Hungary had this far-right prime minister just take over who was anti-everything, everything non-Hungarian, every ethnicity that you could think of. And just this far-right movement and kind of a longing for almost the Soviet days. In the Soviet era, Hungary produced buses and they exported buses to the Soviet Union. Everybody had jobs and everybody, no one did really well, but everybody was kind of okay. Fast forward a couple of years and you have this movement that took place in big parts of Europe, the refugees and Le Pen in France and some of these other movements, Brexit in the UK, the Trump phenomenon in the US, but this kind of disaffected group of formerly as John mentioned, people that didn't have necessarily the highest levels of education, but you could do okay. Like in my area of New York on Long Island, we talked about this a couple days ago as we were preparing for this talk. The largest employer on Long Island up until the mid-1990s was Grumman Corporation. Grumman was a defense contractor. They built the lunar modules that landed on the moon. Grumman was bought out by Northrop in the early 90s. Northrop eventually closed all the Long Island manufacturing and moved down to Georgia. But there was this huge hole, this vacuum left. If you worked at Grumman, you could be a member of the union without a college degree and have a very comfortable middle-class lifestyle in a section of the country that was very costly to live. Not anymore. The largest employer in New York State is a company called Northwell, which is a healthcare company, one of the biggest in the country. Very few people away from custodians and people pushing stretchers don't need advanced degrees, education certificates, everything from physicians to nurse practitioners to radiologists, so on and so forth. So there's kind of been this different, and I think a big part of what's happened in the U.S., whether it was assembly line workers in the heartland of the country that worked for the people that have seen this, just the economy shoot past them over the last 15, 20 years, and, you know, they're going to make America great again. Well, you can't go back to the 1950s. It's a different world. And without having skills or something that's going to allow you to continue to prosper and do well, makes for a very difficult world. And I think, certain of these geopolitical movements that we've seen have kind of played into people's fears and expectations that, immigration is a big part of it. My job was taken over by someone, very different than what I am. And, that's kind of always been that way in the U.S., and I think that we're going to change that. There are 11 million undocumented immigrants in the United States. I'm not kicking out 11 million people. So you can complain and kind of long for the way things used to be, but it's very, the one trend that's tough to fight is demographics.
Yeah.
And I think that's what the U.S. is dealing with.
And is it part of the problem that, because John mentioned robots and artificial intelligence, there was a time where if you were unskilled or semi-skilled, technology would blow you away.
Yep.
But nowadays, even if you're high-skilled, but you just have the wrong skills, you can get gone by. But technology, you take your own, you were a Wall Street trader, lots of the guys you probably worked with in the 1990s who have been replaced by computers and computers.
Absolutely. And, as you can tell, I'm not terribly smart, but I saw this trend coming. I was an equity trader for a long, long time and was highly compensated for the skills that I had in recognizing how energy stocks traded and facilitating buys and sells orders and then trying to, trade. It's all algorithmic now, where people just put the parameters into computer programs and they slice and dice orders to, thousands of orders over the course of the day, and will buy 17 shares every 27 seconds, and that's how they're trying to, but it's a completely different world. I relayed an anecdote of a friend of mine who I went to high school with who was an avid Trump supporter, and Joe did everything he was supposed to do. He excelled at athletics and academics in high school. He went to Harvard, he left Harvard, he got a job at Credit Suisse, did very, very well as a fixed income trader, eventually becoming a manager of one of the areas, and then did phenomenally well. All of a sudden, that business has changed, and all this trading is being done by computers and programs and algorithms now, and Joe is working for a second or third tier firm, longing for the days of the way things used to be. It doesn't go backwards. It can't undo progress. So in many respects, this highly educated, affluent, guy is no different than an assembly line worker from Detroit somewhere, kind of longing for the days when he was king of Texas.
And you mentioned just a few days ago, you sat in front of Trump a few years ago at a baseball game. Do you think his policies are going to make America great again?
First of all, why is America no longer great? Right? We still, there's a lot of things that America does really well. So I always thought that was kind of a disingenuous campaign slogan, among other things. But I struggle to see how some of these policies that have gotten elected are going to be implemented. For example, we in the U.S. it pays among the highest corporate income tax rates in the world, some 35% or so. And the model that is always held out as something that we should strive for is whose? Ireland's, 12.5%. That ain't happening. The U.S. is not going from 35 to 12 anytime soon. But what if we went to 20? Great. So all these U.S. companies have all this excess capital that they no longer have to pay the United States government taxes. And the money will no longer be held offshore in places like Ireland that have more favorable tax rates. But that money is not going to go back into investment in plants and equipment. It's going to go towards increased dividends. So who owns shares? More often than not, the wealthy and affluent. So they're going to get richer still because the dividends are going to increase. If they don't increase the dividends, they do share buybacks. So when they start buying back shares, the price of the shares go up again. Who's going to benefit? So I don't think that a lot of these potential things that Trump is talking about have a shot of being implemented. And you look at kind of the position that they're in already. You've seen healthcare. Strike one, and we're working on another one that looks like it's going to be strike two. So if you can't get things done, if you're not getting that traction, and you know, in the U.S. we have these midterm elections coming up in 2 years, and all of a sudden that's going to be right on top of us again, and nothing happens. So again, back to put my finance hat on for a second, we love when nothing gets done out of Washington. As long as you can't change the game and we're in the stagnate, that's fine. We'll figure out a way to make money and how to make things go. It's when they get real nervous is when Washington, on either side, looks like they're going to be able to implement policies that run the risk of upsetting the apple cart a little bit. So we'll see. But I would be, I think that the Trump bump that the markets have experienced since November have the potential to turn into a Trump slump in not too distant future.
Trump bump, Trump slump. John, what, as an economist, what do you like about Trump's policies? No, don't you?
Says to the cop, look what happened, the truck in London, it swept the whole left-hand side of my car, and the cop shakes his head and says, "You guys are so materialistic, you haven't even noticed that actually it's worse than that, because it swiped the whole left side of your arm away from below the elbow." And the guy says, "Oh my God, where's my Rolex?" But just back to that idea that traders, markets, and investors, how difficult is it for them to take into account, to get a reading of what's going on in geopolitics at the moment?
You know, obviously, it takes a lot to try and boil down what some of this rhetoric is, and you know, trying to decipher, you know, the new regulators trying to decipher what it actually means and its impact on the markets. But one of the arguments for the strength in equities in particular over the last couple of years has been that there's no other game in town, that the returns on fixed income products and certificates of deposit are not existent anymore. But the only way to get an acceptable rate of return, whether it's for your retirement fund or endowments, any pool of capital that needed income, was to buy equities. That was the only. That, I think, is a very, very dangerous game. That when it comes to that that premise that the only reason to buy stocks is because it's the only way, that's, as I said, my experience has been that's a very kind of tenuous reason to, and not terribly supportive for higher equity prices. And I think you're seeing some of that as, you know, blue chip stocks that do have, you know, high yields, and I own a number of them myself, Procter & Gamble, DuPont, oil companies. They tend to do fine, but this kind of narrowing of the pyramid that you do have these, you know, four or five different tech stocks that are essentially driving the NASDAQ index. I just think, and I've, you know, said this to friends and on other bar stools over the course of the last couple of years, that this is going to end in tears. At some point in time, I don't know when, it might not be anytime soon, but I suspect it will be. This is not going to end well. That ultimately, you know, someone's going to recognize that the emperor has no clothes on, and you know, we'll see a contraction in stock prices, and this argument that it was the only game in town is going to be proven to be you know, kind of a not so great reason to have been in the markets over the last couple of years. But you know, we'll see. I was wrong once before.
We've spoken a lot about the U.S. Maybe move around, and something I heard you say a few days ago might be really struck me. We're always thinking about sort of where are the bright spots in the global economy. And people might say China or emerging markets or something like that. But you said one of the bright spots is Europe. Boy, nobody has said those words for a long, long time. Why are you optimistic here on?
No, I think that I tend to. As I said, I'm not real smart, so I try and simplify things. And I kind of think of the world as three components. Asia, right, China, and India have been, you know, just an engine that drove the global economy for the last 15, 20 years. Still going well. Compared to Driscoll, Murphy was an optimist. But traveling around Ireland, how much nobody sees things my way. It's all, you know, it's just I wouldn't say pessimism, but just not a lot of enthusiasm as to what Brexit might mean for the Irish economy. And that I find odd. I'm not normally noted for my optimism, but I do think that there's a tremendous opportunity for Ireland going forward.
I'm going to validate that by disagreeing with you. just in terms of the situation in Europe, it seems like apart from two. First point I made, I do think that we're now in a cyclical upswing. So austerity has been pushed off across Europe, and the European Central Bank somewhat belatedly now probably stimulating the Eurozone economy, very substantial quantitative easing, interest rate low, it's from the growth of the economy. So I think we're starting to get demand growth. Optimistic side for the reading in particular. But I'm worried that the longer term demographics are going to reach against Europe, our GDP growth is low. So I think it's still going to be, in Europe as a whole, struggling to reach 2% growth, given those underlying conditions. In terms of the effects of Brexit, I suppose here, my view is very much informed by the sort of economic literature on this. The particular tool that economists, are informed by, particularly the effects of Brexit, something called the gravity point, which really shows how trade takes place between peers and countries. And very intuitive, close together, you tend to trade more. And also the empirical work that shows that if you have trade barriers between countries, it really enhances trade. When you put those two things together and you have trade barriers between countries with a lot of potential for trade because they're close, you can have a very damaging effect on trade. And you put that then with other literature that really shows that trade really supports sort of productivity growth, so that if you have a self-inflicted trade shock like Brexit, the evidence really shows that it is going to harm growth over the longer term. So there will be some opportunities when the trading partner closes itself down, but on balance, the effects tend to be negative. Now, these are relatively small effects on a year-to-year basis, so at the most, it might not have a percentage point of growth. In some sense, you never even necessarily be able to say that it happened. The Irish growth rate, hopefully over the next number of years, will be 3% plus, so you can have to point out that. The argument that Brexit had any effect, but those effects tend to accumulate over time, it would be 5% poorer after the next 10 years. So I think they are big effects. It's hard to...
But isn't there a potential for it to pivot more towards the continent, away from the UK? I mean, granted, the UK is closer, but it's not... You're not going across oceans.
Sure, and that definitely will happen. So trade is not going to fall by the amount of reduction in trade in the UK, exactly as you say. It will be towards other countries. But on the whole, when you take away that opportunity to trade, where it's really easy to trade because the country is so close to you, and there's other advantages in terms of common language and the long history of trade, I think it is going to have an effect. So I would say it's going to be hugely detrimental to the Irish economy. I think it's very hard to say that on balance this is going to be a good thing for the Irish economy.
I'm struck by you said that you're surprised that the Irish people aren't more optimistic, more upbeat. That's been your experience, Irish people. Why do you think that might be? What are the main positives that you see? Why do we speculate that the Irish people don't see them in the same way you do?
Probably the weather, mostly. I don't know. I don't know the answer to that. But as I travel around, I've always made a point, whether it was a cab driver or the president of NUIG, of asking kind of what your opinions are, how do you think Brexit, what the implications are. One thing that my time in Ireland has taught me that nothing has ever responded with yes or no. There are layers upon layers that, as an outsider, I don't pretend to understand all the nuances. But it's not exclusive to Ireland. It's a similar kind of attitude in the U.S. these days that, very different against something we were talking about before the talk started tonight. In the U.S., every generation has always been brought up that we were going to exceed the expectations and the quality of life of our parents. And I have two sons that are 25 and 27, and even they, have had a lot of advantages and gone to very good boarding schools and everything else. And they have some of that same sense where when you ask them, and I deal with a lot of young people and always ask classes the same question: how many of you think you're gonna exceed the lifestyle and quality of life of your parents? But I asked my own two sons, they went back to their prep school for reunion. I was like, do you guys send your sons to this prep school if you had them? And the two of them said, we would love to, but we don't think we'd be able to afford it based on the way tuitions keep rising, which was shocking to me. You know, both my boys have good jobs, are successful, are well on their way in their careers. But I think there's an expectation or a fear that the time of the 80s and 90s and early 2000s are not going to be duplicated anytime soon. And I think John, you know, mentioned it when we talked about growth rate. Like 3% was not that unrealistic in the 80s, 90s in terms of GDP growth. I don't know anyone outside of the President of the United States that thinks that 3% is doable in any time soon in the United States. It's a big economy, big number. It takes a lot to get there. That's a little troubling. So it's not exclusive to Ireland, but I think the younger generation has a little bit different expectations than what our generation
had. When I lived in the States, I remember coming back every summer for holidays in the late 1990s. At the time, the Irish economy was growing about 10% per year, boom, we hadn't been in 1994. But when I went back and would say, how are things in Ireland? And one thing I did remark, you don't see that growth rate in the people. Somehow we people dress it sort of down clothes, maybe it's the weather, sort of, you know, it was a lovely day, the paper it later. That sort of moved. And I remember him saying to me, you know what, it takes about 10 years, a decade, strong growth between by the time it really seeps into people's. He was about right, because you came here in 2005 and 6, I tell you, you saw conspicuous consumption like nobody else. We were able to do it all right.
So did the number of months.
Indeed. But I guess perhaps the recession, which was so deep and lasted such a long time, it's going to take a good few years for the recovery to really seep through.
That real estate plays and people's the wealth effect of having your home price go up 20-30% has a big impact on that. I know. Again, in conversations that I've had with people, that this idea of property ownership in Ireland and how the property rates are doing, and you know, listening to the radio today, how long house homes are on the market, and average prices all around the country, that plays a big part in how people feel about their circumstances.
Yeah, I think that's a big point, and also goes to the generational conflict that you talked about. There's actually a really interesting article in the Sunday News Chronicle, Sunday newspaper. And he really compared how different generations were doing, particularly in terms of how they were being affected by the housing market. So I forgot exactly the names he used for different generations, but I think the generation between 25 and 29 was a generation abandoned. Because these are people who can't get into the housing market because of the new restrictions on access to credit to qualify for a mortgage. He actually had a more colorful term for the next generation. Share these for the generation that did get huge mortgages and during the housing boom really left stranded in the situation. They benefit from the fact that interest rates are actually very low, but still they have a huge amounts of debt. So different generations have been affected in very different ways. And then older generations who would have taken out mortgages earlier.
Everything that an economist would look at, no inflation. so growth would not really point to an urgent need to raise rates at this point in the cycle, right? But we talked earlier about the growth and the cycle being kind of long in the tooth and the potential for things. I wonder if, again, as a former trader, I'm trained to see Indians climb every trade, but I wonder if these central banks aren't thinking to themselves that the only way to react, one of the few levers that they have to press in a crisis is this idea of lowering rates. If rates are very, very low, and in some cases almost zero, you can't really go that much lower. So to hike rates from 2 to even 4% over a period of 2 to 3 years, at least in the event of a crisis, it gives them a little bit of scope to try and, you know, offset things being bad, that they have a little bit of a wiggle room if they were to try and lower rates.
Yeah, I think that's why we're back to this examination idea where we need to come down so low, we need to lose it lower them. And you say that sometimes we need to be good, maybe we can see push rates up and give themselves that room. And Alan is absolutely right that the insurance increase very negative on but at the moment it seems that the markets are not expecting interest rates to rise that much. So if you look at long-term interest rates, they're very low in long-term interest rates. It can be seen as giving an indication of what short-term rates are going to be over that period of time. There was an article in the Financial Times today that actually noted the flattening of the yield curve, so long rates actually falling. So yes, interest rate increases would be incredibly disruptive, but it seems at the moment because of this fundamental shifts in the economy that are drawing down long-term interest rates, that the likelihood of rate increases, at least based on the participants in the market, in the state, is that they're going to stay low.
Well, I won't believe that the market's always right, right? But flat or inverted yield curve have forecast like 12 of the last 4 recessions, so I'm not so sure that it's infallible. There's certainly these old Wall Street sayings which have been around forever, and a lot of them for a reason. And one of the longest been around forever is this idea of don't fight the Fed. The Federal Reserve is telling you that rates are going up. They're saying we forecast this one in June, rates went up in June. We're going to have another meeting in September. You'll start seeing press releases, but they're telling you rates are going up.
They're not very much?
No. But again, because they were so low, they went up boom. So they go up 25 basis points. They go up another 25 basis points.
But even in the longer term, so yeah. They're not going to be rate rising, but they're going to be limited in number. Yeah. So that even longer term, based on Fed produces all different members produce their own objections for what it's going to be. I can't remember exactly when we allowed those yet, but still, you know, they're still quite low even a number of years out.
Yeah.
So there will be rate rises, but at the moment, the policy makers in the market still expect them to be still.
And again, if you've been a market participant for some period of time where rates were 2%, if they go to 3%, does it change anything? Goes to the period that at some point it does, but they've been so low for so long, I'm not even sure that if the rates double, it necessarily derails all your calculations.
But one effect it may have is one of the reasons bond interest rates are low is that central banks are buying up these bonds. They bought these bonds at low interest rates, in other words, they paid high prices. The interest rate and prices are the opposite of each other. So when interest rates rise, the prices fall, at least on paper, a lot of central banks are going to lose a lot of money. And some of them, we might be looking at a lot of central banks around the world being insolvent, whatever.
But if you hang on to maturity, that's just fine. And central banks, if one thing they have is staying power.
Sure do. They can create money. By the way, open it up to the floor. And I'm very interested in this Michael's puzzle that why aren't more native Irish in a more upbeat mood, given the economy growing at a decent clip the last few years and all the strengths that the Irish economy have. Maybe some people from this side of the club will have thoughts on that. But it's open for any sort of questions you have for the panel or any thoughts any thoughts that you have. Somebody want to kick off? Go ahead.
I was just wondering,
last year, protectionism and kind of anti-globalization, and this idea that it's kind of a rejection of the principle of specialization of labor and free trade across the world. It's hard to believe that the Americans actually believe that, or even don't believe it. So I'm just wondering about what's, or is there kind of a phase that countries go through where they stop the news and economic theory and then actually learn together what they have?
John can answer better than I. Is there any economist anywhere in the history of the world who doesn't believe that free trade is better for all concerned? It's one of the few formulas where one plus one will actually be three. What I think Americans and a lot of people in the world have to start understanding is that what the president says and what's actually implemented are often very, very different. I've been out of the country for a month or so, but last I heard, the Mexicans are still not paying for the wall. He's backed off from this idea of declaring China a currency manipulator. And a lot of the tweets and a lot of the points he made that got him elected, I think are going to go into the dustbin of just, you know, the president says so many crazy things that people just don't pay attention anymore. And I think that's dangerous because, I mean, some of the things that are just, I'm not going to call them lies, but that are just so far-fetched that, you know, you just look. If it were your six-year-old saying this, you'd say, that's just not true. It's not dark outside right now. But I think that this idea of, you know, shutting down trade and protectionist policies are not going to stand the test of Congress and economists' scrutiny.
Just to add to that, so agree with like the universal view of economists is that free trade is good for all the countries involved, but not necessarily for all individuals in each of those countries. And as we talked about earlier, we're living through a period of time where there's essentially segments of the world that are done very poorly. Now there's been a lot going on over that period of time. Trade liberalization being part of it, and growth of China as a competitive market. The bigger thing that the economists think has affected labor markets is what's happening between the technology, automation,
entire industries changing.
So that's the big topic. But there is evidence, I think, reasonably convincing evidence of, for instance, China has also been partly responsible for this, and how much polarization on the labor market. So we were, it's very hard to be competitive in the US in manufacturing now because not having to compete with countries that have such a cost advantage in those areas. So I think there are people that are being hurt by trade. But there's probably only more who believe that the difficulties that they're facing, and those difficulties are real, are caused by trade, and are caused by other things. So that sort of creates a real opportunity for populist politics, and Trump has really exploited that. So there does need to be a policy reform to ensure that people aren't being left behind in terms of programs, not taking away people's healthcare. Striking things is that people are often voting for sets of policies that are very much against their own interests. In addition to the sort of economic explanations for the sort of polarization that you see in the politics, this seems to be also opposed to this, is a cultural sort of explanation. Recently talking to an American equivalent, probably winding up a little bit by saying that if you designed the president, Obama would be perfect actual intelligence, emotional intelligence, and so on. And if you design the worst possible president, it would be Donald Trump, his narcissism, control problems, and whatever else. And he looked at it and he said that he thought it was exactly the other way around. That, you know, having backwards in terms of who was the perfect president.
From what the other party sees, and there's no there's no room for debate. You're wrong, I'm right. And that, I think you've seen a lot of that around the world when it gets to, you know, the situation in France, what I alluded to in Hungary a number of years ago. It's there's no gray area anymore. It's my way and you're wrong. And
this gentleman, a question.
Thanks, Alan. The one element that wasn't mentioned regarding the attitude to Brexit is the media. I don't remember one positive article anywhere about Brexit in any of the media forums. It was all negative. And I think a lot of it, one of the most powerful bodies in this country is the farming body. They are going to be devastated. And they are a very powerful organization. And the other thing I wanted to say was, it's very hard to fight that, you know? But I, on a personal level, I worked for an American multinational for 13 years, Boston Scientific, and I was a product builder on the production line. And over those 14 years, I left last year, the whole atmosphere in the company changed completely. It was a very positive atmosphere. The terms and conditions were very good. There's nothing wrong with the company at all. What happened was people became disillusioned with outside factors, USC and so on, and all the rest of it. And they brought it into the factory. They brought their baggage in. And it changed completely, totally. Even though the terms and conditions didn't change, and they were very good, it was a very good company to work for. So that's all I want to say. Thanks.
That's a good point. Actually, there is a positive comment, somewhat positive comment. Today, in today's Irish Times, John Fitzgerald, the economist, wrote a piece. What he points out is that we should be thinking about one number when we think about the effect of Brexit. We should be saying stuff like Brexit is going to knock 5% off Irish growth or 3 billion off Irish output. That we've got to be thinking about a range, because nobody really knows. And the range that he used, he said it could be anyone from -7, which is bad, to +1. So the overall effect of Brexit could be positive for the overall Irish economy. And the argument is exactly what you've said, that there will be certain sectors hit negatively, but other sectors will be hit positively, and it might be the positive effects overall outweigh the negative effects. I mean, certainly we need to go down by the Docklands, down to the Tree Arena down there, where Ed Sheeran has been a few weeks ago. I knew I had to drive my daughter down there. The place is it's just full of cranes. We have the crane measure in Ireland. You look out of you're up on a high building and you count the number of cranes. Well, that was in 2005, 6, 7, disappeared. Boy, they're back. And from the Tree Arena at the very end, you can go across the river. J.P. Morgan had bought that building across the river, 1,000 people in the office, all the way up along. There's new hotels, there's high-end student accommodations at the Gibson Hotel, all the way up along to the convention centre and beyond. It's skyscrapers, I'm not quite sure it's good, but massive office building. I mean, Dublin in 5 years' time is going to be, Collins Street, Grafton Street is just going to be a few shops. The centre of Dublin is going to be down in the Docklands, that's where it's going to be tens of thousands of people. A lot of working in financial services, and that's the benefit.
Is there any sense,
Alan,
that it's positive Brexit, that it's positive effects?
That's hard to quantify. Some of it will be some companies that would not have moved to Dublin. But part of it is just growth.
I just want to very quickly say that's Dublin.
Yeah.
What about the rest of the country?
Yeah.
You know, what's happening
with that?
That's all.
That's a real problem for. I mean, that's one of the big impacts that Brexit's going to have. It's going to make the regional balances worse because the benefits are going to be concentrated, but the costs are going to be concentrated in areas that are like agriculture and food or like manufacturing, and that's outside of Dublin.
But if Dublin does very well, but the rest of the country be compensated for
it? Don't debate.
How would you suggest that? What sort of compensation?
You're saying the impression could be wrong.
Yeah.
When you say some sectors will do very well, no doubt.
Yes.
And others will suffer. What can be done for the ones that are suffering? the ones that are being very successful, will they pay extra taxes and do something? that the web can be spread.
There is quite a lot of evidence that success in the long run economy is very built on urban economies. And often it's one or two sort of major urban centers in the country, particularly for innovation intensive industries. They really need that scale for them to be successful. So if we're going to be sort of successful in the innovation intensive economy, we are going to need our cities to thrive. Now, it doesn't just have to be Dublin, it's no reason why there can't be other major urban areas, like Galway is the candidate, I think it's also mentioned Limerick as well positioned geographically to be the other pole. But I think we can expect that the growth is going to be very concentrated in urban areas. And that really means that we really have to solve the housing issues. More general accommodation issues for businesses as well. Because probably the best growth strategy for the non-government parts of the country at the moment is the fact that there's such a huge housing crisis in Dublin, and so costly that people can't locate them, and businesses are finding it very expensive to locate them as well. But I think the more general point is that we have to recognize that there is going to be that urban concentration in growth. And then there will have to be sort of compensation models in terms of the tax revenue generated by moving government that hopefully support other parts of the
country. I see three hands. This gentleman here, this gentleman, have you taken that over? One, two, three.
Good. Anybody have a few on converts and cards?
Can we take three questions?
Yeah. So I used to be here, but the triggers sector, because I would be wondering what his reaction to this would be. And one of the thoughts on my mind is that something like this needs to be thought of again. We need to think about a replanning and a rephrasing of our entire economy, society, and political sector to really make us ready, not just for Brexit, but for the next 20 to 30 years. Education, we need another route to the crown.
Thanks,
Aaron.
Just wonder how quiet would be to talk to you, because about 2 weeks ago, I was talking to Clerk of Works in the building section of that car. He told me there were 79 grades in the skyline of Dublin. There was only 9 north that they were living. When he was leaving London, England, he said, boss there towards him, look, the M25 is a 360 degree circuit in London. That business is 360 degrees. Ireland is Dublin. It's only 100 million people. The other 100 million are in the sea. You see, that is Ireland. He says, the 100 million degrees around here, 15 Dublin. Don't need it, if you have any sense.
Well, I've been told that crane drivers are looking for 100% increase in wages, so that's the supply and demand.
I did go to Dublin for 2 days last week, and a meeting with the director of Fulbright Ireland there. Maybe miss Galway. Dublin's like any other city. It's crowded. People bump into you. And when you're from New York, it's very tough to be wowed by another city. But Dublin was very crowded, very active, a lot of cranes, a lot of stuff going on. I walked down to Trinity like every other American tourist. I have this book of Kells, right? And the construction down there in front of the entrance to Trinity was amazing. The whole place was under construction and fenced in. Not very attractive, but you also kind of, what you see in parts of the U.S. now is the infrastructure programs start kicking in a little bit. What I'm assuming, something similar happened in Ireland as you went through the recession and things were cut back. All, you know, these projects were put on hold. Now that we've apparently been through the worst of it, things are starting again. You're starting to see construction take place and delayed infrastructure projects, you know, coming online. But you know, it's, and again, I don't pretend to be an expert, but just looking at this as an outsider, Ireland is a Dublin-centric economy. I don't know what percentage of the population is in Dublin and its environments, but I would guess a quarter or so. It's very much as Dublin goes, the rest of Ireland seems to go. And right now, to me, double is booming.
Cryptocurrency, fintech and stuff like that.
Yeah. Too volatile to me. To me, cryptocurrencies are something that very wealthy Chinese, Russians, and Latin Americans use to move money. And, you know, a great number of the students that I teach at my university on the lab are Chinese. Like 75% or so of our graduate business school are Chinese students from generally affluent families. These kids know more about cryptocurrencies and how they're using and how to mine data and move, but it's an anonymous way for people to move wealth away from the prime lines.
My apologies, this has been a great session, but I did promise to have the next 7 o'clock and it's 7 o'clock, and I know there were other people that had their hands up, so my apologies to them. Maybe we will do it again sometime next time you're visiting. So just leave to me to close up the session. Can I just thank Tom Acton for support. Tom is the head of this. Can I also thank Aisling Lennon from the School of Business for all the preparation he's made. Appreciate your contributions and made for a really good session. Most of all, I thank